Hi, welcome to SCI-FI London's The Pulse, bringing you the best news from the sci-fi world. In the news here at SCI-FI London, we'd like to share our excitement about futuristic anime film Strange Frame, whose progress we have been following for a long time. However, they still need to raise a little money for their project, and you can help by clicking the link below and donating. We'd love to see them at one of our future festivals.
My name is William Hurt, and this is SCI-FI London, and it's good.
Just a little reminder that submissions are now open for our 2012 festival. SCI-FI London uses withoutabox.com for submissions, and there's an early bird discount if you get your films in right now. So filmmakers, get your cameras into gear. Talking about films for our festival, we can now confirm the dates for the 5th SCI-FI London 48-hour film challenge. It will take place on the 14th to the 16th of April at the Apollo Piccadilly. So put it in your diaries and start scouting locations now. Next up, here's the Masters of Creativity, Dan Abnett and Andy Lanning, talking about their work.
Both Andy and I had grown up reading, like I said, Captain Marvel, Warlock, Jim Starlin, basically, but also the other seminal work, I think, was the original Star-Lord story that Claremont and Byrne had done, which I remember reading in reprint in Star Wars Weekly, because obviously in the UK you're getting things in a different format. And we both have quite a British sensibility about what SF means, but also the idea that to us, although we're quite happy with superheroes, and that works really, really well. If you put a Superman in a sort of man in tights in a real world situation, it can often be slightly odd. But a superhero in space, it's more often that his costume is just what he's wearing. It's his uniform or whatever. You know, Nova to us was a space cop in a uniform. He's not a superhero in a costume. So that it oddly, the incredibility of it adds a layer of credibility to it. You can have people doing things where it actually this is sort of business as usual. It's very exciting from our standpoint because it looks wonderful and spectacular. But it's actually more about a world where people are super strong because they're aliens or they've got power armor or they've got, you know, things like that.
Anything could go because nobody had any ties to those characters. There wasn't years and years of continuity where they've been in a regular book for decades, and so there's no way they're going to kill these characters. I think that's what made it even more interesting and slightly edgy from the reader's point of view. I think we definitely made a conscious effort once we'd gone beyond Annihilation. We were actually building a sort of meta story to the whole thing, was to try to make the characters as interesting as possible, you know, because again, it could be, the setting can be as wild and wacky as possible, as long as you've got an interesting touchstone character, like we did with Nova in the first Annihilation, we did with Peter Quill, Star-Lord in Annihilation Conquest, and then during the course of the run of Guardians of the Galaxy, we put in Jack Flagg as a sort of human character through which the readers can relate all this wackiness through the eyes of somebody who's seeing it as if from their point of view.
Be sure to catch us talking to Rebecca Isaacs, illustrator of the Angel and Faith comic series. Here's a little snippet.
It's really difficult, and I think it's something that most comics artists aren't prepared for at all, because you know, you don't really think about it until you try to do a likeness book, but superheroes are so wildly varying across the board in the way their faces look. Even the length of their hair can change from issue to issue. There are style sheets, but they're very inconsistent, and you can't always get them from your editors if you're working at Marvel or DC. Sometimes they just send you a PDF or a zip file of a bunch of different cropped panels from different issues, and they're just like, okay, here's a general idea of what this character looks like. But with that, I mean, everything has to be perfect. You know, if they have tattoos, they need to be in exactly the right place. I mean, these fans know the structure of their faces and their bodies and their hair and the style of the clothes they wear inside out. So there was a lot of pressure on me for that reason. But I really like it now. I mean, I feel like I know these people more so than when I was working on superhero books, where you're just kind of personally removed from the characters a bit.
And now here is Scott Farrah talking about his work on Transformers.
Michael Bay always wanted to shoot real. When I first met him on Transformers 1, he said, we got to shoot these miniatures, and he wants miniatures in the show. But I would gently remind him that we couldn't do this kind of shot or that kind of shot or whatever. Why? Because, well, a miniature is real easy to shoot if you have a lock off, where the camera's locked off, doesn't move, no panning, no tilting, no big crane move, and it blows up or falls down or what have you, whatever it's going to do. And you shoot it at high speed on a film camera, typically. And now we've got HD cameras that'll go high speed. Mm-hmm. And, well, that's all fine, 120 FPS or 300 FPS or whatever. But now we're with Michael Bay shooting shots where I'm shooting aerials where there's a huge sweep around a building or a huge move down the street where it's a dolly move or a crane move, always soaring, always moving. How do you do that with a miniature? That means the camera has to move, well, you know, 100 kilometers per second or something, and literally that's a true speed. It can be, you know, 50, 60 miles per hour on a, and we've done that, but you're practically destroying the camera and all the mechanisms to do that while you're shooting high speed while the event occurs. This has forced us to produce more photographically realistic looking, physically looking simulations of breakage and movement and smoke and fire. And so we've had a whole team of people in ILM for years now developing these simulations that are copies of real world physics. And that's how you make this stuff look better. You know, another thing we can do is go to super, super high speed for some of the robot transitions. One complaint that we heard was that people didn't get to see all the transitions and all the movement and all the articulation in Revenge of the Fallen, number two, Transformers. And so we went the other way with ultra slow motion, and I think people really loved that. And with the slobber coming out at slow motion and the debris falling at slow motion, where you get to really, really analyze and see and enjoy the moment.
Here's an exclusive interview with Christopher Paolini talking about his new book, Inheritance, which was released on the 11th of November.
Aragon actually was a practice book for me. I was a very, very methodical kid. So I had started by writing short stories, and then I tried writing some books, and I never got past the first few pages. So my parents got me a number of books on how to write. They saw I was interested in storytelling and stuff. And I spent a good chunk of 1998 reading books on how to construct stories, how to plot, create characters, build worlds, stuff like that. And then I plotted out a book that I never actually wrote. And I did that saying, you know, I just want to see if I can construct a story. Once I did, then I said to myself, okay, I know I can construct a story. Now I'm going to see if I can plot out a trilogy, because of, you know, I was reading fantasy, so, you know, all great stories were trilogies, right? It has to be a trilogy. And then I'm going to write the first book, and that's going to be a practice book. So I plotted out all of what became the Inheritance Cycle, start to finish. You know, and certain details have certainly changed, but, you know, the main framework was there. And then I plotted out the first book in much greater specific detail. Spent a year writing that. And then somehow it just took over my life. And my practice book, I just finished my practice book, you know, this year, essentially. I never really thought that I was going to go on and finish the rest of the series, necessarily. But I did love the story, and I loved the characters, and I'm certainly glad I did. And a lot of my influences are about what you would expect. I mean, it was Tolkien, of course. It was Anne McCaffrey. It was Raymond E. Feist, magician. And then his subsequent books, David Eddings, Andre Norton, Jane Yolen, the Redwall series, Brian Jakes, Dune, of course, that had a big influence on me. All this stuff that I was just reading as much as I could and just sort of digesting it. And then with Aragon, my goal was to basically write a tribute to all the things that I loved about fantasy and to try to give back a little bit to this genre, these types of stories that I love so much and that had given so much to me. So my idea was to, you know, to take a lot of the standard pieces, you know, the young man with the coming of age story, the magic sword, the dragon, the wise old mentor, the evil villain, and then to put my stamp on that type of a story. I've been able to move ever more into my own voice and my own direction. So I started with standard elements, and then by the time you get to the fourth book, it's very much my own story.
To finish up, here's a sneak peek of the film Darkest Hour, which is released on the 13th of January, and it's sure setting our pulses racing.
Welcome to Moscow.
Look at this place.
One, two, three.
Human casualties are massive. It's impossible to make visual contact. They're absorbing all our power supplies.
This wasn't just Moscow. New York, London, Paris, Tokyo, all reported invisible invaders.
They came here with a plan. They can see us, but we can't see them.
What do they want?
Energy, electricity.
Oh my God.
Get inside!
The way it lit up that cop car, electricity gives it away. Warning devices.
Go, go!
We're gonna fight the hell back.
Thanks for watching. Hope to see you next time. Just a little.
It's got a point in there. Just in the corner. I'm like, hang on.
What's wrong with me having a pint? That is highly representative of me.